Well, let's turn to Deuteronomy chapter 6 and read what the significance of these commandments are. Now, this is the commandment, the statutes and the rules that the Lord your God commanded me to teach you, that you may do them in the land to which you are going over to possess it, that you may fear the Lord your God, you and your son's son, by keeping all his statutes and his commandments, which I commanded you all the days of your life, and that your days may be long. Hear, therefore, O Israel, and be careful to do them, that it may go well with you, and that you may multiply greatly, as the Lord, the God of your fathers, has promised you, in a land flowing with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. And these words that I command you today shall be upon your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children and shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise. I'll skip ahead a few verses to verse 10. And when the Lord your God brings you into the land that he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give you, with great and good cities that you did not build, and houses full of all good things that you did not fill, and cisterns that you did not dig, and vineyards and olive trees that you did not plant, and when you eat and are full, then take care, lest you forget the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. It is the Lord your God you shall fear. Him you shall serve, and by his name you shall swear. You shall not go after other gods, the gods of the people who are around you. And we will end there. Now you can see what God is teaching to the Jewish people here. The laws he is giving them are to keep them and bless them while they're in the land. They're to keep them from following after the other gods. And God reminds them that going into the promised land, it is he who has gifted them with all of these good things. They have not earned their houses. They did not build them. They did not plant their vineyards, but they will reap the harvest of them. The promised land is a gift of God, and the laws are there to keep them in that gift. Obedience to these laws does not merit the promised land. And this is what we'll talk about today. So growing up, I heard through a variety of Christian preachers time and again that if anyone kept the law perfectly, they would deserve to go to heaven. And that those who disobeyed it without Jesus on their side would go to hell. Now, how many of you were taught this as sort of the basic teaching of Christianity? Yes, I certainly was. And how many of you were taught that the law of God is the basis for all good societies in all places at all times? Again, that's something I was taught. Well, I think, and it's harsh to say, but I think this has to be one of the worst mistakes in Christian teaching. And yet it is perpetuated in church after church, Sunday after Sunday, so that most all the world thinks that Christianity is a religion that is full of laws that reward you for obeying. And you get to go to heaven if you obey these laws. And then it sends you to hell for disobeying these laws. It's lamentable that our witness for the love of God has been so perverted. Because nowhere in the Bible does God promise heaven and eternal life for obeying his commandments. What we've just read is that God will keep people in his blessing in the promised land, not in heaven, but just in the promised land, if they keep the covenant. You see, the promised land and heaven for us is not a reward. Nothing that the Jewish people did deserved the promised land. It is the gift of God. So let's see if we can put the law of God in its proper place in our story. Now, there's probably no story more used and abused than the giving of the Ten Commandments. You see, when I was in college in my Hebrew class, we had a teacher who was from Jerusalem, and he thought memorizing scripture was quite important. So we had to memorize two passages out of the Old Testament. We had to be able to recite them and read them. And so obviously that took quite a bit of work, more than if I had to memorize them in English. Now the first was Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4 that we just read. The other was Exodus 20, the Ten Commandments. And as I spent a lot of time rehearsing these passages, I was always struck by how the Ten Commandments really begin. And this is never how it appears when they're written out in public places. It always begins in public places with the command, but what it begins with in the Bible is the relationship. God says, "I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery." You see, God is always beginning with saying, "This is who I am, so do these things." God is placing these commandments, even the Ten Commandments, within the family story that we've been talking about. He is the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob. And that is the basis of the giving of the commandments. God isn't speaking to all people at all times, but to the Jewish people that he brought out of Egypt. Because they were in that relationship with him, therefore he gave them those commandments. He hadn't brought anyone else out of Egypt. He hadn't blessed the other nations in the same way. He didn't have the same kind of relationship, and he did not give them the law. And when God gives the law to the Jewish people, they all stand before Moses, and Moses asks, this is at the end of Deuteronomy, he says, "You know, I've laid before you all of this, the blessings and the curses that will come upon you if you agree to this covenant. Now, do you agree?" And all of the assembly of the people in the wilderness all say together that they agree to this covenant. They entered into it willingly, and of course for their descendants. But the non-Jewish people were not part of this group. Nor was Abraham, for example. Abraham did not have the laws of Moses, nor did Adam, and nor have any of the non-Jewish people groups throughout countless generations. You see, God gave this law to the family of Abraham's descendants. And now I've been telling you that we get to be part of this family, not because we have blood relations with Abraham, but because we're adopted into God's family in Jesus Christ. Shouldn't this mean, then, we might think, that we're part of this covenant that God is making with the Jewish people at Mount Sinai? If we're part of Abraham's family, then aren't we part of the covenant of Moses? Well, not exactly. You might think that, but that kind of oversimplifies the history. You see, the promises of God to Abraham have no requirements that Abraham has to follow. Abraham doesn't have to really do anything for them to come true. God makes sure that the promises he gave to them, the promise, you remember, that was of three things, that he would have many descendants, he would have a promised land, and that he would be a blessing to all the nations. Those three things would come true, regardless of Abraham's behavior. And that's what was so amazing about that story was Abraham consistently did wrong things. He consistently pretended that Sarah wasn't his wife. And there was the situation with Hagar and all of these other things. But God is true to his promises, and no matter what Abraham does, God makes sure that his promises come true. Now, when God gives the law at Mount Sinai to Moses and the people there, it's of a different kind. It has all sorts of requirements. God says, if you do this, then this will happen. Indeed, one of the Ten Commandments says, honor your father and mother so that you will live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. If you honor your parents, then you will be blessed with long life in the promised land. So what God is doing in the law is setting up a way for the Jewish people to stay in the promised land, to stay in his blessing, to keep in mind, at the front of their minds, the point, the whole purpose for which they're in the promised land, and that's to be a blessing to all the nations. So you see, when it comes time to think about us as being part of this covenant, we have to turn to Jesus. In the New Testament, in Jesus' teaching and Paul and in other writers, they all make it clear that Jesus has opened a way for non-Jewish people, of which I am and I assume many of you are, to be included in the people of God without regard for the law. Now, how is this possible? It is because Jesus is himself the fulfillment of the law. The book of Hebrews says that the law is a shadow of the true reality. Jesus is the reality to which the law was pointing. And when the true thing appears, the book of Hebrews says, when the light itself appears, the shadows pass away. So the law is not binding to the Gentiles. And this was what the early church decided in, we read about in the book of Acts chapter 17, at the very first church council. You see, in the early church, you know, the 12 disciples were all Jewish Christians. And most of those first followers were all Jewish. You remember Jesus went into the synagogues, and Peter would have went into the synagogues until he was called to the Gentiles. And Paul, even on his missionary journeys, the first place he always went was into the synagogues. The first Christians were all Jewish. But then Gentiles started coming in, and they had to think about this. This was the biggest question of its day. What do we do with these non-Jews? Do we make them get circumcised? Do they have to come to the temple? Do they need to offer sacrifice? Must they cover their heads? All of those questions. And the early church said, no, they don't have to do any of those things. Gentiles are included in the family of God without regard for the law of the Old Testament. And so it is with us today. The law of God of the Old Testament is not binding on us because Jesus is its fulfillment. But what then is the law for? And what do we do with it today? Now, after God gives us the Ten Commandments, he gives it two places in the Bible, in Exodus 20 and Deuteronomy 5, God sums up the whole point of the law in this way. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your strength and with all yourself. Now, this passage is really the core passage of the Old Testament or the Hebrew Scriptures for the Jewish people. And it is what Jesus himself cites when he sums up the whole of the law. This is the famous Shema, which is just the first word of this passage. Now, the law was given to the Jews at the beginning of their wilderness wandering so that they would have a guide to get them through the wilderness of life. And when they came to settle down in a promised land, a land full of people who worshiped idols, God wanted to be sure that they would keep in his covenant and not become jealous of the other peoples. And that's why we read in Deuteronomy 6 the importance of keeping his laws and that God is jealous for these people, that they would worship him alone. So God gave the Jewish people his law so that they would be uniquely his, and that they would be distinguished not just by bloodline, not just by lineage, because foreigners are welcome as well, but by their unique way of life. And this was a way of life, I think, that was designed to challenge the people that they were around. Remember, the promise of God to Abraham is that they would be a blessing to all the nations. And this is how they're going to do it, by living in such a way that they are similar enough to be understood, but different enough to critique the way that other people lived. They had one God, not many, and they wanted to honor him in every way they lived. So the law was there to really critique the other people groups that they were around and call them to be reconciled with the one God. And so in that day and age, there was no distinction, as Reformation theologians tried to make, between the moral, the civil, and the ceremonial law in the Old Testament. You see, to worship God alone implied many things in that day. It meant not sacrificing your children. It meant worshiping in a certain kind of way. And it also meant doing justice to the widow and the orphan, as we'll see in the books of the prophets. The distinctiveness of the Jews carried to all parts of their lives, not just to the form of worship or to their sense of justice. Now, it's important that the Jews were different, but it's not just being different that's important. As I said, they had this special relationship with God, and the law was really a sign and a symbol of that relationship with God. It kept them pointed at God. It kept them in a reconciled relationship with God. It always pointed them back to him. And that's why the whole law is summed up in Deuteronomy 6:5. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart. Love God, that's what the whole law is about. But what does that really mean? You know, people today talk about your personal relationship with Jesus. We talk about loving God, but what does that mean? What does a relationship mean with a being who is totally different from ourselves? We can't carry on conversations with God. We can't touch him or see him or taste him or smell him. He doesn't hug you when you're lonely, and he doesn't wipe away your tears. He's promised to do so when we get to live with him in bodily form, but he doesn't now. He doesn't meet you for coffee to catch up on life, and he doesn't watch the football game with you. So what does having a relationship with God really mean? It means being faithful to God's promises. Now, we talked a lot about the promises of God to Abraham and his descendants, and how in all manner of difficulties, God was faithful to his promises. So what does God want from us in return? Well, to be faithful to those promises as well. For Abraham, this meant believing in God. For the Jewish people in the Exodus and later the Kingdom of Israel, this meant keeping the laws that God gave them. And this is what it meant in Jesus' time as well. Jesus was faithful to the task that God gave him. And he perfectly kept the law that God delivered on Mount Sinai. In fact, he so perfectly kept it as our representative, he did it so that no one else would have to. Not even the Jewish people need to keep the law anymore in Jesus. So in Christ, we see the faithfulness of God to keep his promises. And we respond in faith. We respond by being faithful to God by obeying his commands. So God gave his commands to the Jewish people in the wilderness. And what was the promise that they were going to be faithful to? Well, they had grown numerous, right? Remember, there were the three promises. One, that they would become numerous. And now they've done that as they leave Egypt. And that they would live in the promised land. And that's what they're heading toward. And the third, again, was that they would be a blessing. And that was really their mission. The whole point of becoming numerous and having the promised land was so that they would be a blessing to the other nations, that God would work through the Jewish people his reconciliation with all the creation, not just with a single group of people. But if the Jewish people disobeyed, if they forgot their mission, they would be thrown out. And this, as we'll find out, is exactly what happens in the history. Now, this is an important point. As I said at the beginning, obedience to the law of God in the Old Testament was not rewarded with the promised land. The promised land was given to Abraham without regard for keeping the law. But the laws were there to keep the people there, to keep them as a blessing to the other nations. And so long as they are a blessing, they would continue. Now, in that day and age, the promised land was an actual physical place. They didn't know really about the resurrection of the dead. They didn't have a concept of when you die, you go to heaven. They believed in a place called Sheol, that we know from the book of Ecclesiastes, they believed everyone who died went to Sheol. It wasn't hell, it wasn't a bad place, it's the land of the dead. Everybody who dies is dead. They're buried in the ground, and what happens? It wasn't really well established until much later that they had this belief that people went to the bosom of Abraham. So heaven isn't the promise of God. Eternal life isn't the reward for obeying God's commandments. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that. Eternal life is not a reward for obedience. The promise of eternal life is given in Christ alone, and it is a gift of God, not a reward. So God's law is not given to us to search out the good moral principles for healthy living. It wasn't given to us at all. God's law was given to the Jews in that day and age, for those people at that time, to be a blessing to the nations they were around. And that is our mission as well, to be a blessing in our own nation, to all the nations around. But we don't do it by keeping the law of Moses. We do it because we're included in God's family in Jesus Christ. And what is that command that Jesus gives us to which we must be faithful? John says this in the book of 1 John, "And this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he commanded us." So do you want to obey the commandments of God to you? Then believe in Jesus. Believe that he gave his life for you to bring you back into a right relationship with God. And believe that he has come to you, not just so that you would be reconciled with God, but so that you would be a blessing to others and call others into that reconciled relationship. So you can demonstrate the love of God. You can demonstrate your faithfulness to the blessings of God by loving him and loving your neighbor, and indeed loving all of our enemies. For such were all of us, as Paul reminds us, such were all of us before we were reconciled with God in Jesus. It's not about obedience to law, it's about sharing the love we've received. And if we love God, then we are promised by our Lord that we will live with him forever. Not in a place that we've built, like the Jews entering the Promised Land. It's not that we are building heaven, but that God has prepared a place for us, a place that we get to live with him. And that is the eternal life that we get to look forward to in the resurrection as a gift. So now that we know the proper place of the law of God to the Jewish people, we know that it was a shadow of things to come, a shadow of Jesus Christ himself. Now that the reality has come, the shadow passes away. In Christ, we are free to share the love he has shown to us. So go and love one another as Christ has loved you. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blessing you've given us in Jesus. We thank you for the law that you delivered on Mount Sinai, that the Jewish people could go through the generations attesting to your faithfulness. Lord, we pray that you would give us the same mission and we would understand that same mission to tell others of your faithfulness. And it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.